Ethos Space Resources recently published a study on lunar water. I previously covered this company on my channel. Check out the video for details. In brief, Ethos aims to develop lunar infrastructure, including roads and landing pads, by processing lunar soil. They also plan to extract lunar oxygen to sell as propellant for lunar landers and spacecraft. Let's explore Ethos Space Resources' study on lunar water to gain insight into their strategies for prospecting, harvesting, and processing lunar water ice. We know the lunar water ice exists in permanently shadowed craters around the South Pole. Limited data available from orbiting satellites and a number of rovers landing on the moon suggests lunar ice is present within the regolith under the surface, though the top meter of soil appears largely ice-free. To pinpoint high-yield ice deposits, drilling deeper and collecting samples is necessary. Unfortunately, NASA's Viper rover has been cancelled, leaving recent discoveries to China's Chang'e 5 and 6 rovers and a joint Japanese-Indian probe. While DARPA's upcoming LASA mission will deliver improved orbital data, it won't provide the granular, localized insights needed for extraction. Only future ground-based exploration that's equipped with deep drilling rigs or trenching tools and advanced geophysical sensors will provide the high-quality data needed for commercial harvesting of lunar water ice. Water, the oil of space. On Earth, oil is a fuel that powers economies and civilizations. In space, mobility drives progress, launching into orbit, changing trajectories, transferring to planetary bodies, and landing. Earth's deep gravity well forces spacecraft to burn most of their fuel just reaching orbit, leaving little left for maneuvering. The rocket equation's harsh reality demands exponentially more propellant for longer journeys. Without orbital refueling, a thriving cislunar economy remains out of reach. The first step involves building orbital propellant stations supplied from Earth. However, to scale cislunar exploration and commerce, we must source propellant elsewhere. The obvious first place to source rocket fuel from is the Moon. It's only a few days away from Earth and has a shallow gravity well with easy communication. Lunar water ice extracted from regolith and split into hydrogen and oxygen by solar-powered electrolysis can fuel spacecraft and landers using liquid hydrogen and oxygen. Even for methane-oxygen vehicles like SpaceX's Starship, lunar water ice supplies 85% of the required propellant. Where is lunar water located? Ethos is only interested in concentrated deposits of ice, believed to be located near the South Pole of the Moon. It's possible volcanic glasses on the Moon may have water trapped within them, but their low water concentration makes them unappealing for commercial purposes. Only polar ice deposits align with Ethos's goal for lunar water extraction. Can we commercially extract lunar water ice today? No. We lack the detailed data needed to pinpoint optimal locations for lunar water mines. Extensive survey sampling is essential to gather the high-quality data needed for a commercial mining operation. Currently, no one knows the precise locations of lunar water ice at a scale relevant for mining, as the necessary data simply does not exist. Evidence for water ice in the Moon's South Pole region. It's likely that permanently shadowed regions near the South Pole contain water ice, acting as cold traps. Water delivered by asteroid or comet strikes, or from debris in ejecta, enters these frigid zones and remains trapped due to temperatures too low for it to escape. Over time, this water accumulates. Data from NASA and international satellites provide moderate evidence of water ice in these cold traps, though not as extensive surface deposits or thick, pure subsurface layers. The top 20 to 30 centimeters, that's 8 to 12 inches, of regolith appear largely dry. NASA's La Crosse mission deliberately crashed into a cold trap, and the resulting impact threw a plume of material up high where it could be analyzed by satellites and Earth telescopes. The analysis suggests that water ice is between 2 to 9% by weight of the plume. Further analysis suggests this ice was buried at a depth of at least 1 meter or more. The regolith above was largely ice-free. Ethos thinks that if the ice present is in the lower range, say 1 to 2% by weight, it would be more economical to generate oxygen by heating the surface regolith to high temperatures and electrolyzing the molten regolith to extract oxygen. How pure is lunar water ice? The La Crosse mission revealed that lunar water ice contains various compounds beyond water. The mix of compounds varies by cold trap, depending on the temperature within each permanently shadowed region or crater. Some compounds vaporize when temperatures exceed specific thresholds, leading to unique chemical profiles in each location. Some of the contaminants are a problem, such as mercury, which is highly toxic and could damage the electrolyzers needed to process the ice deposits. This adds complexity, and therefore cost, to the lunar ice mining operation. How to locate economic lunar ice deposits? On Earth, teams conduct ground-based field surveys, often supported by drones or fixed-wing aircraft. Recent advances add AI-driven data analysis and predictive modeling to improve results. For lunar ice, an extensive drilling campaign is essential. Drills must penetrate the regolith to depths of 1 meter or more, paired with an extensive set of instruments and sensors to characterize the lunar regolith. Ethos also highlights the need for new, low-altitude orbiters, flying as close as 10 kilometers above the surface. This lower altitude would improve the resolution of maps, better identifying regions likely to contain water ice deposits. What would a lunar mining operation look like? The problem for lunar mining operations is that the places likely to contain water ice in sufficient quantities to be commercially viable are not near enough to places of high solar visibility. When nuclear fission reactors are available, that problem goes away, as you can position a reactor near the cold traps. But for now, solar power remains the primary energy source. That's the first trade-off: less power where there is more water ice, or more power where there is less water ice. The next decision involves extraction strategy. Dig up the regolith and move it to a central site for processing, or beam energy directly into the ground to capture water vapor in a mobile unit. The problem with the beam option is it doesn't look like there is much water ice to be captured near the surface. The water ice could be a meter or more below the surface, requiring enormously powerful beams of energy to heat up the regolith sufficiently to capture water vapor. Transporting regolith presents its own challenges. Hauling hundreds or thousands of tons out of a crater to a sunlit processing site demands a lot of infrastructure, such as roads, pulleys, lift systems, each costly and time-intensive to build. Processing within the crater avoids this, but requires placing equipment in an extremely cold, dark environment, increasing power needs for both processing and operations. Ethos thinks the first mining site would involve a central processing site powered by several solar towers, providing about 1 megawatt of solar power. The icy regolith would be dug up by a small fleet of mining rovers, transported about 5 kilometers from the crater to the processing site, where the icy regolith is purified, electrolyzed into oxygen and hydrogen, condensed into a liquid state and stored in propellant tanks. Future mines would scale up using more power and positioning processing facilities closer to ice deposits. For craters like Haworth and Shoemaker, Ethos anticipates relying on nuclear fission reactors to meet the energy demands of mining in these challenging environments. Ethos estimates that a lunar mining operation requires about 20 tons of equipment, with current market prices averaging $1 billion per ton to deliver to the moon's surface. Lunar ice mining is not yet commercially viable. SpaceX's Starship, cited in DARPA's Lunar 10 study, could potentially reduce costs to under $10 million per ton to the moon. However, this reflects SpaceX's internal cost, not the price they would charge customers. Despite falling launch costs driven by reusable rockets, market prices remain high due to limited competition in the heavy lift launch sector. It's uncertain whether SpaceX would offer a $10 million per ton rate when they could charge $1 billion. Even at the lower price point, it would cost $200 million to drop the 20 tons of equipment needed to start mining ice. For now, lunar propellant production likely requires subsidies from NASA, other space agencies, or governments to become viable. A relevant proposal comes from Tory Bruno, CEO of United Launch Alliance, who advocates for government-funded strategic propellant reserves in low Earth orbit, low lunar orbit, and on the moon's surface. Such reserves could jumpstart lunar propellant production. For more details, check out my video on strategic propellant reserves. Upcoming missions. The most relevant mission to prospect for lunar water ice was NASA's Viper mission, but unfortunately it was cancelled due to cost overruns. China has landed a number of lunar rovers, including sample return missions with Chang'e 5 and Chang'e 6. In 2026, China will launch Chang'e 7 that has a mini hopper probe that will try to enter a permanently shadowed crater and take basic measurements for the presence of water. Japan and India are planning the Lunar Polar Exploration Mission to explore for water ice. It's not expected to launch before 2028. Ethos finishes with these final thoughts about mining the moon for water ice. The main hurdle to mining water on the moon is a lack of information. Regardless of any claims to the contrary, the data does not exist today to locate a mining site with any confidence in how deep the ice is or how much there is. Some upcoming efforts like DARPA's LASSO can narrow down more promising regions, but dedicated ground-based exploration is a billion-dollar hurdle before any mining can begin, unquote. What do you think about the prospects of mining lunar water ice? Leave your thoughts in the comments section below. Okay, that's a wrap. Thanks for watching. Space News Live is on Saturday evening or Sunday morning, depending where you watch from. I recap the videos I posted this week, answer questions, respond to comments and chat messages, cover any missed news, and preview upcoming content. I'd love for you to join if you can. Be sure to like and subscribe so you'll see our upcoming videos. We make videos every week covering the space industry, with an emphasis on the smaller space startups that aren't covered so well on other channels. See you soon!